Today, Black Lives Matter activists have unveiled a comprehensive set of policy changes that they want to see get done both on the federal and state levels. Now, Margaret, this comes after months and months of discussion between protesters and activists of what exactly they should be writing up and what they should propose. Now, they drew inspiration from the president's task force on 21st century policing. That is something that Obama wrote up and signed in December of 2014. Now, that was to, you know, speak to the obvious problem that we have. And in this country, and Black Lives Matter activists felt that they should do their own. And the project's called Campaign Zero. Here are some of their proposals. Here are the more obvious ones that you might expect. They're calling for body cameras, better training, community oversight. You know, the first things that really come into mind when you talk about how to address this issue. But they get into some really interesting things that a lot of people aren't talking about, and I want to get into those. But before I do, I want to give you guys a quote from a guy named Samuel Singiawe. He's one of the people behind Project Zero. He helped write up this proposal. Now, he gives a really good idea of what exactly it is that these activists want. So let me go ahead with this quote. "Folks are almost not even able to imagine an America where people are not being killed by police. That is the norm in many other developed countries. It's about challenging that notion and really showing that through policy change, we can get very close, if not achieve that goal." So, in my opinion, all it takes is one look at a chart, which we have for you guys, comparing how many people are killed by police in this country to other very developed modern countries in the world. Look at the U.S. at number one, of course, with 1,100 people killed in 2014. Now compare those to numbers in Germany, U.K., Australia, Japan. They're in the single digits. Japan with zero. I mean, it's not a matter of, you know, we have a much larger population. It's about our policies in this country. It's about racial profiling, and it goes very, very, very deep into who we are in this country. And it's just extremely sad to me because obviously I read you that quote, and what he's asking for really is that we just are like these other modern countries. They're not saying that one group of people are more important than the other. They're not saying this, they're not saying that. They're just calling for something very simple, that through policy change we can get some serious reform done. And I think this country, and I don't think it's a debate anymore, I think this country needs that. So let me get into one of them that I found very interesting. Decriminalizing harmless offenses. Now, amongst those, spitting, disturbing the peace, loitering, trespassing, disorderly conduct. Surprisingly, marijuana possession and consumption of alcohol in the streets. Now, consumption in the streets of alcohol as well as spitting, I mean, very different things, but all things that African Americans are constantly targeted because these are all very ambiguous things you can pin on anyone, like disturbing the peace, for example. That's just another tool that a lot of people are claiming that, you know, the police force in Ferguson were using in order to decriminalize African Americans, unfairly ticket them more than other people to create revenue for the city. So getting rid of these harmless offenses might stop police officers from being able to do that to African Americans in the community. We'll go on to the next one, but before we do, I want to ask you, what do you think so far, Margaret?
What do I think about these ordinances or these laws?
Well, first
of all, Nick, most cities across this country already have ordinances in place that deal with public loitering, spitting, disturbing the peace. These are issues that are already being tackled on the books. Like, there's no need for new laws. I will say that, though, in conjunction with saying there is no question that black lives in this country are targeted disproportionately to anyone else. They seem to have higher rates of arrest. Police killings are higher in that community, and we need to do something about it. Now, with that said, you know, as somebody who has walked on the street before and I walked into somebody's spit line, they spit all over my hair and my dress, I am totally anti-public spitting. I found an ordinance in Minneapolis dating back to 1898, 117 years ago, they had anti-spitting ordinances on the books. These don't necessarily target black community members. Now, I think maybe in this case they do, but nobody should be spitting on the street. Try spitting in Singapore or Dubai.
There are issues
all around there that I really can't stand.
I totally get it, and I get where you're coming from, but you have to understand that, you know, no one is pro-spitting. Like, let me spit. It's just that point that they're trying to get across, right?
But maybe
these harmless offenses.
Right. Maybe there should be mechanisms in place that keep society orderly and functioning for everyone so that everyone can enjoy it without, you know, being accused of being a lurking racist. Now, is this a racist issue? Most definitely. Are they disproportionately targeted? Most definitely. Yeah. Should there still be ordinances against spitting? Most definitely.
Yeah, that won't necessarily solve the problem of racism in this country.
Right.
But I do get where they're coming from. Now, the next one that I really want to talk to is about the militarization of the police. And they want to see the opposite. They want to see demilitarization of the police. pass legislation to prohibit police departments from using federal funds to purchase military equipment, as well as pass legislation to prohibit the use of military weaponry currently in police department, in the police department's possession. So very simple. Less weapons, less artillery, less deaths. Because right. in a country like Japan, for example, where we saw on that graph zero people killed, there's obviously less guns. The police have less guns, so it doesn't take rocket science.
Police officers aren't necessarily armed, right? And I'm sorry for cutting you off, but in the UK as well, they're armed with batons.
And whistles.
Only in the United States do we arm police officers, this open carry situation. But I will say, conclusively, citizens in some states, the District of Columbia not so much, but in some states, there are open carry, you know, the ability to open carry alongside with police. Now, that creates a different set of situational circumstances that we're not talking about here. We're talking about Black Lives Matter. These specific rules, I feel like they do target unfairly. I will say that. They do. Right.
Good. So I'm glad to see these, you know, legitimate propositions being put forward. I think it's a really huge step, but I think so far the movement as a whole, I think they've really done a good job in getting their point across. And I mean, everyone in the country is talking about it. I mean, we saw Bernie Sanders when he held the rally, right? We saw the video of him getting interrupted. A lot of people spoke about whether that was the right move on these activists' mm-hmm. part. That's up for debate, however you want to see that. But as well as in New Hampshire, when Hillary was at that forum, she was speaking, Black Lives Matter activists trying to go in mm-hmm. And storm that place. They didn't let them do that like they did on Bernie Sanders. We saw the same thing with Jeb Bush in town hall. He had a Q&A. We saw them chanting as he was on his way out. So they're really making their voices heard, and they're really in the public's eye right now, which leads me to believe that this is going to be a really big part of the presidential debates coming up. It's something that, you know, people are having more and more pressure on them to talk about it, these candidates. So I think so far they've already done their job in a great way. The fact that they're coming out with really good proposals now to make really sweeping reform in this entire country just adds to that. They're not stopping. So I'm really glad to see that, because like I said, this is really, really something I think we need to see change in this country, you know, for African Americans, but everyone else in this country, because, you know, people shouldn't be dying like this in the hands of the police.
I agree. There is no question. I want to reiterate this before we stop.
Yeah.
There is a major problem with racism in this country where Black lives are concerned. We need to address it. I'm not sure that these ordinances are the way to go about it. I think that we need to overhaul our entire system and start with the body cams on every police officer in this country. I think that that would go a long way as opposed to these, you know, little, does this ordinance work or not for which community?
Either way you look at it, though, whether you agree with Margaret or you don't, I mean, I think it's symbolic in a lot of ways. Like that one talking about spitting. That's they don't care about spitting. I don't think that African.
Well, you mentioned it that was an issue and an ordinance on this paper, and so that's why I pointed that out, because personally, I'm very anti-spitting, but neither here nor there. We do have a serious problem with racism. I'm glad that at least we have that dialogue where it's opened up and we're talking about it.
Exactly the point that they're trying to get across now. So let us know in the comments below on these propositions being put forward by Black Lives Matter activists. Let us know in the comments below, and if you haven't already, subscribe to the LibTV for more.